Hi, this is James Nussbaumer, and this is my book, The Master of Everything, a story of mankind in the world of illusion we call life. In this audio version, in this session, I want to read to you the acknowledgement section and then on to the introduction. I owe a deep thank you to Carol, my editor, a white dove who seemed to sit on my shoulder through her devoted correspondence from Florida to me in an Ohio prison while I was writing this book. Your help, Carol, was like a gentle whispering in my ear. I thank you for your constant clarity and structure in your voice, telling me things like, your reader wants to see your heart. Go there, Jim, and explain this section deeper. And always urging me, make your thoughts alive and real, Jim. You have shown me, Carol, how to release the dreamer in me from dreams of fear. I am grateful for this higher calling. To my publisher, Ozark Mountain Publishing Company, I thank you for your confidence in me and for pulling me in an ascending direction by offering me a home for this work. I feel I've gained a calm assurance of heaven with you. To those authors, poets, publishers, musicians, and other professionals whose names were unavailable for me on material I'd come across during my years in prison, which helped inspire me with the information contained in this book, my grateful thanks to you. Your living in the light while I was writing in the shadows is proof of your extension. You know who you are, and this is my best effort in acknowledging you. To my family, I am forever grateful to you for remembering who I truly am. And now the introduction to The Master of Everything, a story of mankind in the world of illusion we call life. There is not a single doubt in my mind it was divinely intended that my life's journey be greeted by the publication that would open my mind and set me free, A Course in Miracles. These teachings of inner peace have answered my lifelong questions to the mystery of all that exists while proving to me the truth about forgiveness. A Course in Miracles asks us to hear this single question: who is the light of the real world except God's Son? Surely this is a question for us to absorb, but more so, it is merely a statement of the truth about ourselves. For we are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. And the light emanates from your source, which is the creator of all that is real. This is the opposite of a statement of pride or arrogance or self-deception. It simply states the truth about who you are. I am in prison as I write these words by hand into a composition journal, the old-fashioned kind with a black and white mottled cover and lined pages. I look back to when I was first shoved hard into a 6 by 9 foot cell, clothed in rags. As I stumbled to the floor, the overbearing guard growled, "Welcome to the state of Ohio." I sat there on the floor in the corner of that cell, pretty much the same individual as I am today. However, today I see that truth has moved to the front of my mind. I believe this change, both drastic and subtle, had much to do with my survival, since I'd been stripped of my world, or maybe my dignity. Dignity seems like something we need in order to survive as who we think we are. Well, at least we were taught this, weren't we? As I write these words now, I have nothing in this world other than who I am. I often wonder, does this mean I do have my dignity after all? I describe in this book some of my experiences of prison life, but many of them I'll never mention to anyone, only because they really don't matter. I will describe what I have experienced as an undoing of old patterns of thinking, which has been a transformation initiated and then guided by a part of me that eternally lives. The process necessarily required this stripping away in order to bring on the new patterns, which are truly of who I am. I began an inward journey that tells me it will continue because it's taking me where I must go. It's a journey about not only who I am, but also what I am. I can tell you it is peaceful, blissful, and exciting. And I can tell you the same is available for you as well, regardless of your circumstances. I remember sitting there in that stinking cell, moving quickly to the depths of my mind without realizing how deep I was actually going. The experience was definitely more than just what I'd been cautioned it might be. Many would say shock. I heard one guard telling another guard that I must be in shock when I wouldn't answer any of their questions. Something was directing me to go deep, where a feeling or sensation welcomed me. I almost felt like a child again. It was that feeling of being cradled and told everything would be okay. I also know that I had no choice but to accept the embrace. I realized in the weeks and months ahead inside these block walls and steel bars that what had embraced me was my own true strength. It was as if I were being waved on inside of me to join in, but I still had to go deeper where something was waiting to greet me. The sensation was mysterious and encouraging, as though whatever was waiting had been hidden away for all those years of my life. Physically, I was very weak, and this inner place that had been obscured for so long was really my long-lost home. Much of the world lives by a thought system that teaches us that our body should be regarded as our temple. This is true, however, it applies only to the surface of who we express ourselves to be, where gaining and winning are important. But for the most part, honoring the body is only a minor step in answering that one question much of the world struggles with, and that is, who really am I? Our temple is not a structure at all, such as a building or our body. Every temple has its altar where holiness abides. Otherwise, it wouldn't be a temple. But rather than viewing our body as the temple, let's consider the structure of our temple as our true essence or our being. Deep within that structure of life is where our altar actually sits. And it is at this altar where we see our life's purpose. This is what emanates the light, or is the true essence of who we are. This is our being, if you will. I wrote this book entirely in longhand from behind bars in an overcrowded, overbearing, and obnoxiously overloud prison environment where inmates live in one another's faces all day and all night long. The atmosphere is violent and volatile. Often, I believe this is what brought these words from my mind through the pen and onto paper. I sit here and wait to be released by a judge who says he used me as an example. The waiting is extremely difficult, but I know it's temporary. The project has saved me in more ways than one, and as this project grew, I grew as well. I wrote this book solely by myself with helpful suggestions from a oneness of which we are all a part, the oneness I call God. Writing this book has kept me busy each day, and at times I would lose sleep at night, anxiously waiting to pick up where I left off the day before. It has consumed me. Each day I received as a gift of words that I could not seem to find the previous day. I would often wake up in the middle of the night and think, hey, that's it. A sentence that was needed to complete a paragraph or a metaphor to help explain an idea. Something to assist in an area I seemed to be stuck would always appear in my mind when I needed it. When the final chapter was nearing its completion, a blissful feeling continued to flow through me. I knew I was going to miss this project. I was sad, too, because I could not get it to mature beyond the handwritten stage due to the rule in prison stating no computer usage whatsoever in this backwoods prison system. my only other resource was not really a resource at all, but was available if I wished to stand in line to use the ancient, poor quality prison typewriter. But need I say, not nearly up to a publisher's standards. This was a feeling like not being able to send your cherished kid to college, a kid who desperately desired to change the world. But regardless, my words did mature into book form, handwritten into a growing pile of journals. This would be fine for the time being. Help will be on its way in due time, a voice inside me continued to assure me. As the journals sat in the bottom of my footlocker, that same voice encouraged me to keep writing. This book surely is a child to me, and in many respects, it has been like the experience of watching my daughters grow to adulthood. I remember asking them in a joking and affectionate manner on their birthdays when they were very little to promise me not to grow any older. I would say that I wish they could not grow any older. I would say that I wished you could just remain cute little girls forever. But inevitably, sure enough, they did grow up. And today they are beautiful women doing what they must do to make the world a better place. Just like my little girls, this book is ready for its next phase. Sooner or later, the words will be in your hands and hopefully helping those who are lost or confused in their own way, as I once was, or perhaps those who are searching but not certain what it is they actually want to discover will find their true free will as I have. Of course, by the time you are reading this, my task of writing this particular book will have been completed. But from where I stand now, I'm wondering how I will find a publisher who sees it as a part of its purpose to get involved. Other individuals whom I have not yet met will have to arrive onto the scene to help move the process along. I see this as a natural progression, just as the many other adults who arrived to play a role in the maturing of my daughters. I can honestly and openly tell you that I have been advised by the one who knows that I should relax while I proceed with the suggested promotion of this book. I've been advised also to trust that the right people will show up at the right times to assist me with the various procedures. Events are being arranged at this very moment while I continue with my work here in this prison cell. In fact, events are being arranged right now that will give you a reason to seek out this book or come across it or have it given to you as a gift. I have already been instructed to turn over everything to my teacher and guide. My inner guide and teacher guarantees this product will arrive in time as a published book for those who are ready to calmly listen, see, and learn as I have. By the time you are reading this, I will have already been traveling extensively throughout the country, and who knows where else I may land. It is important that I talk to individuals everywhere about what I have learned and witnessed along my own spiritual journey. For those who are already ready and for those who can glimpse readiness, if you can remember that forgiveness is the key to unlocking the door to your own inner depths, then you will live a life that encompasses your own true free will. You will know this to be your home. Thank you, everyone, and look forward to the next session where we will pick up on chapter 1.